Hi, I want to talk about jobs, and I want to try to do two things. I want to try to explain sort of what's going on, and then why so much of what the government is doing is counterproductive. So I'm going to do this in terms of a metaphor. And I hope this doesn't offend people, but I'm going to use kind of a Genghis Khan type of metaphor. I'm going to say that there are three groups of people kind of interacting, or forces interacting. We have the, I'll call the ruthless invaders, you know, the forces of Genghis Khan. And then we have the helpless peasants. And then we have fortified towns. Okay, so how does this metaphor apply to the job market? Well, the ruthless invaders are people coming from sort of the high-tech and finance sectors, mostly high-tech, and the forces that were unleashed by the web. So you've got software developers. You've got entrepreneurs. You've got people who know how to create and exploit supply chains, international supply chains, outsourcing, that all that stuff. You know, people with very high skills that are somewhat scarce. Okay, so the helpless peasants are, in this case, sort of American workers who are displaced by the invasion. So they would be people in legacy industries, things like old-fashioned newspapers or record stores or anything that's, you know, bookstores, Borders Books, things that are being destroyed by the invaders. A lot of it is blue collar work, and we see that going to places like China. And then there's sort of low level white collar work, low level white collar, going to places like India. And so that's kind of the helpless peasant set, people with low skills, young people. So young people with not much experience and who don't have the high tech skills. They might have a BA in the humanities, or they might have no college degree at all and no experience. They might be older workers in these declining blue collar industries, or in low-level white-collar industries. Okay, the fortified towns are people with credentials, and where the credentials have the backing of the government to keep other people out. So things like teachers, where you have to get a teaching degree, a lot of medical professionals. In fact, professionals of all sorts, from high-end professionals like lawyers to low-end professionals, like, you know, some places that you have to be licensed to give manicures or to, you know, to do hairstyling, and just all sorts of things are licensed. The new chairman of the President's Council of Economic Advisors, Alan Krueger, has a co-authored paper where something like one-third of the labor force has some kind of license, and that license helps protect them from outside competition. So my point there is that these ruthless invaders have been going after these people, creating new businesses that have destroyed a lot of these people's jobs or lowered their the wage rate that they can earn competitively. They would go after these people, but they get stopped by the credential protection. So someone like Salman Khan, who I'm inspired by in terms of putting together this talk, He's ready to invade the education industry, but the challenge there is to get credentials for the types of schools that could be created using this sort of technology. So the credentials protect the people in the fortified towns. So that's kind of the overall picture. I think it's been going on for 10 or 15 years, and the result is that these people have been getting more wealth. These people are holding their own, but it's hard to. But their numbers are stagnant. That is, the people paying for this, and it's a lot of them work in the public sector, don't have increasing amounts of money to pay them, and so the number of workers in this sector is stable, but they're holding on to high wages because of political power. And then the helpless peasants are having their wages drop, and they're losing jobs. So their wages are down and their numbers are down. Okay, so what is government doing in all this? So let's put the government in here. And how does it relate to all these people? Well, the invaders, relative to the invaders, the relationship is corruption. The government corrupts the high-skilled people by steering them we steered them into creating these fancy mortgage securities. Now we're steering them into things like green energy, where companies like Solyndra or Fisker Automotive, which is an electric car company, which my guess is going nowhere, they get hundreds of millions of dollars of government guarantees. All that money basically goes to a few wealthy people, a few high-skilled people. Supposedly you create a few jobs for the helpless peasants, but you really don't. And so the relation there is corruption. Government relates to them with corruption. That doesn't really help. With the fortified towns, the government sort of is, in some sense, owned by the incumbents. So owned by the incumbents. And so the incumbents keep their wages higher than they ought to be. My guess is in occupations like public school teaching, in some sense, the fair wage is probably 30% below what people are currently being paid. That is, you would have to cut their wages by 30% before people would feel like they should quit and try something else. But the government keeps that wage high, and then with a fixed budget, that means that that it's the jobs that are scarce. People are complaining that public school teachers are being cut back and we need to send more money into state governments. In fact, we don't need to send more money into state governments. We just need to cut the wages by 20, 25%, 30%, whatever it takes, so that you can actually maintain the number of people. You could allow the invaders to come in and come in with new models in things like healthcare and education. That would make these towns no longer fortified. That would mean these people would be subject to the same problems as the helpless peasants. So wages would come down, employment would be shifted. Maybe some of the people who in the helpless peasant sector could move over into this sector if you allowed the invaders to come in and change the way healthcare and education are done. But government's going to prevent that because government is owned by the incumbents. And then finally, with the helpless peasants, I think the government's role is it pretends to care. Like, this is what politicians are going to say, that they're really going to help these people. In fact, they don't. In fact, they do things that hurt. An example of something that hurts would be things like higher minimum wage, which makes it harder to employ these people. And the big one is putting healthcare costs on employers and mandating expensive, mandating expensive insurance. And that also makes it much harder to employ people who don't have super high skills to begin with. So anyway, the net result is that government's not playing a constructive role. I think if you were to try to come up with a constructive role, I think it might be something like wage subsidies / payroll tax cuts, which I don't think would do a ton, but for the kind of low-end workers, if you could target that to low-skilled workers, to the low-skilled. Not sure that this could actually work, but it's a reasonable suggestion. It could open up try to open up these fortified towns, but at the same time encourage much lower wages in those sectors, because the incumbents are keeping the wages too high, and that's reducing employment. So you really have to kind of do almost the politically impossible of taking these politically powerful people and attacking their allowing their wages to fall or encouraging their wages to fall. So that's unlikely to happen. And for the invaders, just stop being corrupt and just let them develop the industries in the most economically appropriate way, and ultimately they'll come up with ways to hire other people. That's not a very that may not be a very inspiring picture, but it would be better than what government's doing now.